And before we go, Buñol again becomes a sea of red as the Spanish town holds its famous La Tomatina festival. 7 trucks loaded with 120 tons of ripe, juicy tomatoes drove past the town's main street as revelers wearing white threw the fruits at each other. Some even ended up swimming and rowing in tomato sauce. Although Buñol has a relatively small population, more than 22,000 people from across the globe descended on the town to take part in one of the world's most famous food fights. The world's largest toy maker is going green. Lego is doing away with fossil fuel and making its signature bricks with renewable, albeit more expensive, plastic. The Danish toy maker recently signed deals to phase out its oil-based brick by 2032. Thanks to higher sales and increased profitability, the company is able to pay up to 70% more for the plastic resin or raw material to make its toys.
Today we are pursuing a road where we are using the mass balance approach, meaning that we are taking virgin fossil fuel out of the mix of our materials and increasingly putting sustainable materials in, so that could be recycled materials or bio-based materials.
The turnover of the Philippines' main gateway to the San Miguel-led consortium now in full swing. The Transportation Department says the agency and the Manila International Airport are conducting monthly talks with the new NAIA Infrastructure Corporation to ensure a smooth transition process. The NNIC won the bid to rehabilitate NAIA in February, with the consortium expected to spend over 122 billion pesos over the entire concession period. Under the contract, it is obligated to increase the airport's passenger capacity to 62 million in 5 to 6 years from the current 35 million. The formal turnover of NAIA is scheduled on September 14. 8 Philippine and foreign companies apply for government license to explore indigenous energy resources in the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao. The Energy Department says the companies are well-established players in the hydrogen and petroleum exploration sectors. The bid, which formally opened on Wednesday, focuses on 3 predetermined areas within the Cotabato and Sulusi basins for petroleum exploration. The agency says the next phase will assess whether these applications can progress into service contracts. 15 more drugs are added to the list of medicines exempted from value-added taxes in the Philippines. The Internal Revenue Bureau says the VAT exemption now applies to some medicines to treat cancer, high cholesterol, hypertension, and mental illnesses. An initial batch of medicines were exempted from value-added taxes in January. Revenue Commissioner Romeo Lumagi Jr. says this supports the government's trust to give the public access to more affordable health care and medicines. The Philippine Intellectual Property Office establishes new rules to recognize IP agents and lawyers aimed at protecting the public from fraud. The measures, which took effect last week, ensures they have the necessary competence and experience in these areas. A 5-member board will oversee the system. Under the new rules, non-lawyers are required to obtain recognition from the agency to offer these services, while for lawyers, it's optional. The recognition is valid for 3 years and can be renewed. IPOPHL will list recognized professionals on its website, and agents have up to 2 years to comply with the new regulations. The Philippine government returns to the international debt market with the sale of more U.S. dollar-denominated bonds. Treasury Bureau says it will be a 3-tranche bond offering for $500 million, maturing in 5, 10, and 25 years. The proposed bond issue received an investment grade rating from Fitch, S&P Global, and Moody's, aligning with the overall credit score awarded earlier to the Philippine government. The proceeds from the bonds will be used for general purposes, including budgetary support. Last May, the government successfully raised $2 billion from the issuance of the 10 and 25-year global bonds. The government's borrowing program is set at nearly 2.6 trillion pesos this year, 20% of which will come from foreign sources. The Gutianan family's East-West Bank hopes to attract more customers with the launch of its new application, which it says is more secure and user-friendly. More from Jackie Pascual.
PhilInvest subsidiary East West Bank is expanding its digital services with the launch of its Easy Way banking app. East West CEO Jerry Ngo says traditional banks need to innovate amid the rise of digital banks and fintech apps.
Wala nang pinagkaiba ng digital bank tsaka digital apps ng traditional banks. Huh? But the reality is that you need a physical and a digital presence.
Ngo adds they hope to partner with digital banks whose clients mostly have lower savings so these depositors can eventually shift or add an East West account when their money grows.
How we can partner with them, to work with them, particularly as their clients graduate, right? Because most of these guys kasi are, you know, as a fintech, you do not have a collections capability.
Despite beefing up its digital services, the bank says its physical branches will remain open, though the number could be reduced.
The human connection is very important, and I think it will not go away. I don't think the branches will go away. It will probably be fewer or actually more densely compacted in terms of target areas.
East West has nearly 500 branches, including its rural banks, and they will soon transform some branches into so-called phygital branches, or a combination of physical and digital, as a response to the changing banking habits of Filipinos. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
Independent financial services provider and investment house Unicapital Group sees a pickup in investments in the Philippines thanks to easing interest rates and cooling inflation. Lady Vicentia with a full story.
Easing of key policy rates and cooling inflation signal a positive outlook for equity capital markets, according to independent financial services provider and investment house Unicapital Group. But with the Banco Central ng Pilipinas reducing interest rates at a slower pace than it expected, Unicapital has lowered its year-end target for the Philippine Stock Exchange Index to the 7,000 level from an earlier projection of 7,200.
We were expecting up to 75 basis points rate cut for the year. But now we reduced it to 50 basis points. And we had the first 25 bips this month. So we're expecting one more, probably October or December of this year. Hence the decline in our index target.
Unicapital expects stock prices to rise this year, with earnings per share growth projected at 11%. It remains optimistic that the local market is making a gradual recovery back to pre-pandemic levels, as lower interest rates should boost consumption.
It's starting to pick up as I see it when you see interest rates right now, and they're seeing it already starting to stab that. And there's a gradual shift right now to equities. I'm not saying that it has normalized, but somehow when we're seeing now further, again, reduction in interest rates by the BSP, then we should see more interest right now, more momentum going towards the equities market.
For the property sector, lower mortgage rates for residential properties are seen to increase demand by the first quarter of 2025. Properties outside Metro Manila are more in demand, prompting prices to rise faster compared to properties in the metro. Residential sales are seen to rise by 9% in 2025. Leasing businesses are also projected to expand, with the demand for business process outsourcing companies rising by 70%. The strong BPO demand is expected to offset the impact of government's ban on Philippine offshore gaming operations. Unicapital sees the ban to have a negligible impact on its covered property stocks, as most of these companies have minimal exposure to POGOs. Hotel occupancy is also seen to improve by 2% on the back of more tourist arrivals this year. For 2024, Unicapital projects the Philippine economy to grow by 5.8 to 6%, treading on the lower end of the government's growth target. While economic growth is expected to be driven by higher consumer spending and government spending through infrastructure projects, headwinds loom, such as geopolitical tensions and if interest rates remain elevated. Lady Vicentia, ABS-CBN News.
14 Australian investment funds and corporations are coming to the Philippines on September 5 to 6 for a business mission. The Australian Embassy says the delegation, which will come from the agribusiness, resources, infrastructure, and digital sectors, will be led by the Macquarie Group. They will meet with senior Philippine government officials, local conglomerates, and Australian companies operating in the country. The Australian government announced last year it would establish an investment deal team in the Philippines to monitor the business climate and promote Australian investments. Philippine police deny allegations they plan to bomb the Cathedral of the Kingdom of Jesus Christ in Davao City. A lawyer of the group claims receiving a call from a policeman threatening to do the act, but the group can't confirm the identity of the alleged caller.
Isa na namang kasinungalingan ang pinapalabas ng KOJC na bobobohin namin ang kanilang compound. Kagaya ng kasinungalingan na sinasabi nila na pinutulan na namin sila ng tubig at kuryente. Kaya sa lahat ng mga mamamayan, mga kababayan natin, huwag agad kayong maniniwala sa mga pinapalabas nilang mga kasinungalingan.
The search for fugitive Pastor Apollo Kibuloy is entering its sixth day with authorities suspecting he's hiding in an underground bunker inside a property. The manhunt continues despite a temporary protection order issued by a Davao court. Interior Chief Benher Abalo says they sought a clarification from Judge Mario Duaves, who affirmed their original interpretation of the order.
Nakatanggap kami kahapon din galing kay Judge Duaves mismo. Ang tawag niya ay Supplemental El Clarificador Order. Na siya mismo ang sinasabi niya na it does not cancel or nullify, to quote, the processes in related to warrant of arrest. Both serve different purposes and are not contradictory with each other. Na yung ginawa niyang temporary protection order ay hindi nagkakansela o nagwawalang bisa ng warrant of arrest. Dahil iba raw ang purpose ng bawat isa. At hindi sila nagko-contradict. Meaning, tama kami all the while.
Over now to the Congressional Inquiry on Illegal Offshore Gaming Operations in the Philippines. The House Quad Panel lifts the second attempt or contempt order against Cassandra Ong late Wednesday night. But the first contempt order, which puts Ong under the custody of the House, stays. Ong was cited in contempt for a second time for giving evasive answers to lawmakers during Wednesday's hearing. But it was lifted after she responded to the questions of lawmakers and agreed to sign a waiver to open her bank accounts. Calls grow louder to slash the Philippine Vice President's proposed 2025 budget after her tense exchange with House lawmakers. Vice President Sara Duterte this week refused to defend her 2 billion peso budget proposal, which drew flak from House lawmakers. But her spokesperson, Michael Po, defends the Vice President's attitude during the hearing.
Pag ito ay nag-decide ng COA na may notice of disallowance, hindi pa po kasi siya final. So medyo mahirap pong mag-comment sa notice of disallowance. Siyempre po na meron tayong due process requirement kung saan na pagbibigyan dapat ang ahensya ng pagkakataon na i-clarify sa COA yung mga naturang finding.
Meanwhile, the OVP's budget sponsor admits it will be difficult to defend the agency's budget. Congressman Zia Lonto Adiong says they will meet with Duterte to get more data on her spending plan. The budget deliberation will continue on September 10, but there is no word yet if Duterte will attend.
I was hoping that all the questions from my colleagues will be satisfactorily answered by the Vice President. Unfortunately, that did not happen.